I am probably one of the very few Western journalists who is a friend of the Kashmir Bandits. If not the only one.
Only one.
You know, when I came to India, I was very innocent. I didn't know what was a Hindu, what was a Muslim. I came from a culture in my childhood. There was no problems as such, you know, between Islam and the rest of the world. So I came quite new and quite innocent in India. My eyes were open in Kashmir, actually. My innocence got lost in Kashmir because Mr. Ganju and Mr. Giamonji talked about, I saw it with my own eyes. I had gone to Kashmir, you know, in the 70s, and of course at that time I was not a journalist, so I didn't see. But when I started going back as a journalist in Kashmir in the late 80s, when the first killing of the Kashmiri bandit leader happened, I saw it with my own eyes. I was there, and I kept going back to Kashmir, first for a Swiss newspaper called Le Journal de Genève, and then for a very famous French newspaper called Le Figaro. And I actually realized that there was a serious problem with Islam, political problems, social problems, terror problems. In 97, you know, remember there were the first elections in Kashmir in 97. And that was a turning point for me also, because, you know, most of the Western journalists need to sensationalize things. You know, we need something to, that our leaders, you know, in France or in Germany or in UK or in the US, have a feeling that something dramatic has happened. So in 97, the elections, nothing was happening. There was one particular day where all the foreign correspondents of Delhi, you know, there are many actually foreign correspondents, both Westerners and Indian streamers. We were all in Srinagar. There was only one hotel open on the bank. And we were told that Mr. Shabir Shah, who was under house arrest, would surface near the old mosque, near the mosque in old Srinagar. Our drivers told that, because you know the drivers in those days were the informants of the journalists. And so we all rushed to the old Srinagar to meet Shabir Shah. Before that, I had been told that there was a small Hindu temple in Srinagar still open. I think it was a Ganesh temple on the bank of the Jhelum. And it had been attacked the day before by militants. It was heavily guarded. So myself and an Italian journalist called Tiziano Terzani, who died now, a very famous journalist, I dragged him, he was a friend of mine, I dragged him, said, come, we should go and see this Hindu, you know, the last Hindu temple in Srinagar. So we went there, and it was heavily guarded, as I said, because it had been attacked. And I met those Kashmiri bandits who were still there, and they were there. They were very courageous people, and this story touched me so much. So that day I decided I should do something about the Kashmiri bandits, because nobody, neither my fellow Western journalists nor the Indian journalists, thought that it was something worth reporting. They would rather go to Shabir Shah. So I did go to Shabir Shah after that. And indeed, Shabir Shah surfaced, you know, with a few people. They started shouting slogans, you know, especially with the BBC camera and the CNN camera were there. And then they started, you know, getting more aggressive. So the BSF, you know, lobbied a few tear gases. There was a charge. And it was over. It was nothing.
Show is over.
Evening looking, you know, on the TV, on CNN and BBC, there was a very famous BBC correspondent there, not Mark Tully, but they had sent someone from UK. I forgot his name, he became an MP after that. He was there, he was a star BBC reporter. You know, and they did a very clever thing, you know, they zoomed upon, you know, the Kashmiris, Muslim shoutings, you know, and their slogans, you know, and the tear gas, you know, the lights charge, and it looked very impressive on TV. It looked like something very dramatic had happened. But I was there. I knew that, you know, it was so compared to what I had seen in Kashmir, because I have seen, you know, terrible things in Kashmir. You know, I've been to the line of control, I've been with the militants, you know, I've been with the army in night operations. So I know the reality of Kashmir. As a political journalist, you know, covering South Asia, Pakistan, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, even the war in Sri Lanka, Kashmir was the most dangerous place for a journalist. It was the most, I think this is where I faced, you know, the most danger, where I had fear driving at night in Srinagar under curfew, you know, was probably one of the most dangerous things. Going to the line of control, also there was a place where Pakistan would lobby, you know. So it was a dangerous place. So that day I decided I should do something for the Kashmiri Pandits, and we started a foundation called FACT, which is called Foundation Against Continuing Terrorism. And the first exhibition we did was on the Kashmiri Pandits, and we showed it all over the world, including to the Congress in Washington, to the German Parliament, to the Israeli Parliament. That was my small contribution. Now, this is a symposium. Our friend said here, and I should respond to the title. Now, Kashmiri Pandit victims. Yes, Kashmiri Pandit are victims. It's one of the greatest tragedies, you know, of the modern world today, that people have become refugees in their own countries, you know, that they've been shipped out to their homeland, you know, that nobody gives a damn about that. No doubt, Kashmiri are victims, and it brings tears, you know, when you hear the story, you know, it brings tears that such terrible things could happen. We know about the Jews being gassed during the Second World War, but this is one of the most horrifying stories of genocide in human history. Without a voice, you know. As a journalist, as a seeker also, as a seeker of spirituality, you know, I have learned something which is not politically correct to say, you know, that should never be said in public, and nevertheless, I have never been politically correct. So I would say today, there is never total injustice. In this world, if there was total injustice, this world would be an absolute absurdity. It would not be worth living. There is never total injustice. Why are the Kashmiri Pandits without a voice today? Yes, they are victims. Yes, there has been a genocide. Yes, nobody gives a damn about it. But at the same time, their voices are not heard. They're not united. They have 100 groups that keep fighting each other. There's not a single umbrella, you know, which can speak in the name of the Kashmiri Pandits. After all, you know, as our friend said, they're intelligent people, they're the most cultured, you know, the culture of Sanskrit, you know, it's rooted in them. The history of Kashmir is so ancient. Even today, you know, many of them managed to get back on their feet, you know, to educate their children, to do well, to earn money. Some of them become very rich even. Where are they? I have to say that. My first part is that I am a friend of the Kashmiri Pandits. I am touched by their story. I did something from them. In fact, we are building a small museum in Pune on land that has been given to me by Shri Shri Ravi Shankar. And we are going to have an entire wing on the Kashmiri Pandits. I am going to do it. It is my pledge. It is my duty. But at the same time, I have to say, you know, there is no voice. Whenever I met Kashmiri Pandits, you know, when we showed all over the exhibition, first, they didn't come in numbers. Secondly, when they came, they always wanted something. They didn't want to give something to help their own brothers and sisters. They wanted something for themselves. So there is need also of introspection among the Kashmiri Pandits, you know. Why are we silent? True, we are victims. True, we've been persecuted. True, the Indian government doesn't give a damn about us. True, you know. Journalists never report our stories. But why don't we have a voice? What can we do? Now, you said very rightly that some resolution should come out of this meeting. Otherwise, there's no point. You know, we meet, we talk, you know, we feel happy about it, we go home. Then what? You know, you need an umbrella organization of the Kashmiri Pandits, where all the other organizations will agree to come under. I know that it's very difficult amongst Hindus. Hindus are the most disunited people in the world, and it's been their bad karma. It's been their downfall. Muslims could only come because Hindus were disunited. Because there were so many of them. Today even, you know, there are 800 million Hindus in India. Kashmiri Pandits are Hindu, isn't it? So they're part of a larger community, which is called the Hindu community. 850 million, a billion worldwide. Educated people, you know, open people, powerful people. Some of the biggest CEOs are Hindus today in the world, both in India. Why is the voice of the Kashmiri Pandits not heard? Because they're disunited. Because they're selfish. Because they're selfish. You know, that selfishness has got to do something about their downfall. I will keep fighting for them. But at the same time, there has to be some introspection. And I think, speaking of a resolution, solution, there has to be an umbrella movement for the Kashmir, which should be a lobby. It can be a lobby. Not only there will be, you know, the 500,000, 600,000, 1,000,000 maybe Kashmir pundits. Nobody knows how many there are today in the world. It will be a voice for them, but it will be a voice for all the Hindus, because all the Hindus feel concerned about the Kashmir pundits. So, out of this meeting, or another meeting, there should be a resolution that the Kashmir pundits should come under one umbrella organization, and that it should speak in the name of them. Thank you very much.